Hello and welcome everyone. This video is on the topic amenorrhea. So amenorrhea is the absence of menstruation. It may be because of physiological or pathological causes. It can be either primary or secondary. It can be of hypothalamic or ovarian or pituitary or of anatomical origins, ovulatory or anovulatory. Primary amenorrhea refers to a failure of menstruation by the age of 16 years. Okay, so no menstruation by 16 years in the presence of normal secondary sexual characteristics or 14 years in the absence of other evidence of puberty. Okay, so if secondary sexual characters are there and no menstruation, 16 years is the criteria. If there is no secondary sexual character and no menstruation, then 14 years is the criteria for primary amenorrhea. But a secondary amenorrhea is defined as absent periods for at least 6 months in a woman who has previously had regular periods, or 12 months if she has had oligomenorrhea. Okay, and what is oligomenorrhea? Which is the patient who bleeds less frequently than 6 weekly. Okay, so 6 months if she has got regular periods and doesn't have periods for 6 months together, then it's secondary amenorrhea. The prevalence of amenorrhea is about 1%. Primary amenorrhea is rare. About 0.3% of women fail to establish menstruation. Now, this is basically how the whole axis works. The HPO axis, the hypothalamus, pituitary, ovarian axis, right? And any interruption of this axis will result in amenorrhea. Like the hypothalamus releases GnRH, which goes to anterior pituitary to release LH and FSH, and this gonadotropins will act on ovary, and ovary produces estrogen and progesterone, right? And we know that estrogen is responsible for the proliferative phase, progesterone for the secretory phase, right? These hormones also guide in the classification of amenorrhea. So we know the WHO classification, right? Group one is when there is low estrogen, low FSH, and no hypothalamus pituitary pathology. Okay, so basically there is hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. So low FSH and low estrogen. So everything is reduced. Group two is when there is normal estrogen, normal FSH, normal prolactin, leading to the diagnosis of PCOS. Right? So there is only some problem in the hormonal, there is hormonal imbalance, but estrogen, FSH, prolactin, all are in the normal range, and still the patient has got problems with the period. Group three is when the estrogen is less, but the FSH is high, right? So basically this will happen only in gonadal failure cases, right? So whenever there is gonadal failure by the negative feedback mechanism, the FSH will be released and it will be high, but it will not act on the gonads, and that is why the estrogen will be low. Right? Now, these are few causes of amenorrhea. Let's check. So the pregnancy may be seen in primary amenorrhea as well as in secondary amenorrhea. So in cases where these girls who are very young and who have not attend their menarche yet, so it is still possible that they may remain pregnant before their first period, and we may think that it's actually primary amenorrhea, right? So in her very first ovulation, if she remains pregnant, it may show up as primary amenorrhea, but it is basically a pregnancy. Secondary amenorrhea, of course, we know that pregnancy is there, the most common cause. Hematocolpos may show as primary amenorrhea, right? Because there is no way to come out for the menses inside. The hypothalamic dysfunction as a result of stress, depression, exercise, anorexia nervosa, chronic illness, and weight loss. So we all know that a BMI of more than 19 is required for the menses to start. And if there is severe stress or severe weight loss, right, or in cases of chronic illness, all these factors can cause both primary as well as secondary amenorrhea. Now, it has been seen that in cases of empty cella syndrome in patients who have got craniopharyngioma or hydrocephalus, even they have problems of primary amenorrhea. Prolactinoma may show up either as primary or as secondary amenorrhea. Thyroid disorders and Cushing syndromes, same like prolactinoma, so all these endocrine problems, the prolactinoma, thyroid problems, Cushing syndrome, all these may show up as primary amenorrhea at a very early stage, or may show up later causing secondary amenorrhea, right? Constitutional delay, of course, will show only as primary amenorrhea. And genetic disorders like androgen insensitivity syndrome, MRKS syndrome, Turner syndrome will show up as primary amenorrhea, right? Androgen secreting tumors may show up either as primary or as secondary amenorrhea. Medications that you take like antipsychotics, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, or even the drug abuse of cocaine or opiates may cause primary or secondary amenorrhea both. Okay? Premature ovarian failure, it is possible that before the patient starts having a period, the ovaries the function of the ovaries becomes insufficient, and it results in premature ovarian failure, and it may show up as primary amenorrhea from the very start, or may happen later like in mosaic tumors, causing secondary amenorrhea. The PCOS, Asherman, head injury, Sheehan, and chromosomal abnormalities like Fragile X and Turner, as we just said, will only cause secondary type of amenorrhea. Okay? So about 40% of the causes of secondary amenorrhea are basically ovarian origin, because these are happening later on in life. It is only because of the problems with the function of the ovary. 35% are hypothalamic in origin, and only 5% are uterine. The most common cause of primary amenorrhea is gonadal dysgenesis. So remember that most common cause of primary amenorrhea is problems with the gonads, that is gonadal dysgenesis, 43%. Mullerian agenesis is next to it, and constitutional and PCOS is the very last one for primary amenorrhea, right? So primary amenorrhea, basically problems with the gonad. Now you should be knowing whenever the question comes to you and they give you few details about the patient, you should be knowing how to diagnose this patient. You should be knowing all the differential diagnosis, and important to know what to ask in the history of primary and secondary amenorrhea patients so as to come to the diagnosis of what type of amenorrhea it is, right? So the evidence of psychological dysfunction or emotional stress should be asked, because that gives an idea about how she must be affected, right? Mother's and sister's gynec history of relevance, all these should be asked in primary amenorrhea, because this will give us an idea about how to treat this patient, right? So it's important to ask about the mother and the sister's gynec history, because it's possible that it may be a constitutional delay, right? Mother's obstetric history with the indexed child, okay? So if she has got any bleeding, severe bleeding after that, right? Or anything specific that happened with the child, like hypoxic injury during the delivery that the baby suffered, anything that might have caused primary amenorrhea to this patient. Family history of genetic disorders or diabetes. Family history of delayed puberty. Also need to ask about the pubertal development, if there is any lack of pubertal development because of the decrease in the estradiol secretion, which could be due to hypothalamic or pituitary disorder, ovarian failure, or chromosomal abnormality. The presence of galactorrhea may be due to hyperprolactinemia. The symptoms of hypothyroidism, weight loss, weight gain, they all these things should be asked in case of patients with primary amenorrhea. See whether she has got any hirsutism, virilization, right? That may be because of the androgen secreting tumor, or it may also be because of the 5-alpha reductase deficiency. See if she has got any menopausal symptoms like flushing or excessive problems with the mood swing, right? Any of these things will give us an idea of what might be the hormonal structure inside. Ask her about the sexual activity. Ask her whether she has got any problems like headache, visual disturbance, polyuria, polydipsia, because all these suggest the CNS tumor, like craniopharyngioma. Ask about anosmia, because it is also one of the causes of Kallmann syndrome, and see whether she is suffering from any other chronic systemic illness, chemotherapy, or radiotherapy. So basically, you need to ask overall everything related to the health of the patient, and all these questions that are here in the history are basically the causes of primary amenorrhea. Now, in secondary amenorrhea patient, you need to ask about whether her periods were regular before, right? So irregular menstrual cycle, hirsutism, acne, because it may be associated with PCOS, malaise, fatigue, anorexia, weight loss, maybe due to chronic illness. There can be heterotopic ossification, history of, it can be following a head injury, right? And headache, which may be suggestive of CNS tumors, galactorrhea, postpartum hemorrhage, because we need to rule out Sheehan syndrome, which is again a very important cause of secondary amenorrhea, history of dilatation and curettage, because it will rule out Asherman syndrome. Ask her about the medications like contraceptives, antidepressants, antipsychotics, opiates, right? Also, ask regarding any red flag symptoms like rapid virilization, because that will give us an idea whether she has got any androgen secreting tumors, right? Now, what to examine in patients with primary amenorrhea? So we all know that in cases of primary amenorrhea, we should be, it all depends on whether she has got secondary sexual characters or not. It will give us an idea, right? So we need to check her completely. Of course, we need to do the general examination, check her height, weight, BMI, see if she has got shortened height, because that will give us an idea of any chromosomal abnormality like Turner's, right? Women with gonadal dysgenesis and hypoestrogenemia are at risk of shortened final adult height. Their growth pattern should be documented and compared with that of the first degree relatives. See her blood pressure, see her thyroid status, if there are any dysmorphic signs, if she has got any congenital anomaly, right? any hirsutism, acne, check her breast for how much is the development of secondary sexual characters, and see whether she has got any features like that of low hairline webbing, because Turner syndrome is very common to see in these to be seen in these patients with primary amenorrhea. Check the abdomen for pelvic mass arising from the pelvis. Check the groin nodes, see if she has got any hernia, right? Because now this is very much suggestive of androgen insensitivity syndrome patients who have got gonads up there in the groin or in the abdomen, and I mean just show up as hernias. Check the perineum, see whether she has got distribution of pubic hair, what is the size of the clitoris, and see if other anatomy in the perineum is appropriate or not, right? In cases of secondary amenorrhea, the woman's height, weight should be recorded. See if she has got any raised BMI, because it is associated with PCOS. Reduced BMI is associated with stress or anorexia nervosa, right? Like in athlete. Check whether she has got any male pattern baldness, any features of virilization, which may be associated with androgen secreting tumors. Galactorrhea, by doing the breast examination to rule out hyperprolactinemia or prolactinoma. So ask about headache and all, and look for the features of hypothyroidism. Now, what are the investigations you should be doing in these patients? First thing is always check the pregnancy, because that is the most common cause of amenorrhea, whether it is primary or secondary. Prolactin level needs to be checked, because prolactin, if it is more than 1000, the woman should be referred to an endocrinologist, and MRI of the brain should be performed to diagnose pituitary adenoma. Whereas in the secondary amenorrhea, if the prolactin is more than 1000, again, this patient needs to be referred to the endocrinologist, because the prolactinoma can be seen in a very early age as well as in the later stage. The prolactin level, normal prolactin levels are when it is less than 500. Do thyroid function test we are doing the thyroid function test, and we are also checking the testosterone level in the mood, and they are very much suggesting towards androgen secreting tumors or Cushing syndrome, right? Do the estrogen and progesterone challenge test in patients with secondary amenorrhea. Of course, it is not applicable in patients with primary amenorrhea, right? So give estrogen and progesterone, and then withdraw and check whether the patient bleeds. So basically, that is a test for secondary amenorrhea. Sex hormone binding globulin, again, for secondary amenorrhea, because it may suggest PCOS. Free androgen index, DHEA, and androstenedione levels, all these things are needed to be done in secondary amenorrhea patients. Go for transabdominal ultrasound, of course, that will give us a lot of information about the internal organ development and if she has got any PCOS for secondary amenorrhea, if she has got Asherman syndrome, right? Also, in cases of primary amenorrhea, if there is any problem with the development of the reproductive system, do a transvaginal ultrasound only if required, because patients with primary amenorrhea may still have their hymen intact and may not really consent to go for a transvaginal ultrasound. Of course, it needs to be done with the consent. So see if the uterus is absent in primary amenorrhea because that is more suggestive of MRKH or androgen insensitivity syndrome, right? In cases with androgen insensitivity, we know that basically the genetic type is X2Y, but because there is androgen insensitivity, all the phenotype is that of female. Okay, so these patients will not have anything, any reproductive system of that of a female, right? So basically it will be testes, the gonads will be testes, and we also know that these patients will not have much of the growth of hair or anything that is related to the androgen situation, right? Also for secondary, in amenorrhea patients, when you do TVS, check whether she has got PCOS, check whether she has got a normal uterine anatomy. If there is anything which is suggestive of Asherman's, right, though it is a little difficult by doing the scan, but you may still find out. Okay? MRI. So MRI, you need to do, as we have seen, that in MRI, again, you can find out if the uterus is absent or if the patient has got androgen insensitivity syndrome, right? And if the uterus is present, see if the patient has got streak ovaries, which is suggestive of Turner's syndrome. All these things can be confirmed with MRI. Sonohistrography, sono and hysterosalpingography. So HSG and all, they are of course not applicable in primary amenorrhea patients, but they're useful to find out Asherman syndrome in secondary amenorrhea patients. Karyotyping for primary amenorrhea. And if the patient has got very high FSH for 2 times, right? Or she is diagnosed with premature ovarian failure, then we need to do karyotyping to see if there is any problem with the genetic structure in secondary amenorrhea patients. So again, a very important test to be done in for primary amenorrhea, that is LH and FSH, right? So after pregnancy, do LH and FSH. So if the secondary sexual characters have developed and FSH is normal, okay, then an ultrasound can be done to rule out if there is any obstruction like hematometra or hematocolpus, of course. So we know that the FSH is normal, that means the hypothalamus is and the pituitary whole tract is normal. We know that the secondary sexual characters are developed, right? So that means the ovaries are functioning. So basically there can be a problem in the anatomy. If the secondary sexual characters are developed, but there is raised LH and FSH, then it can be, there is raised LH-FSH ratio, sorry. So then it can be a PCOS, right? So basically she has got everything normal, but there is only raised LH-FSH ratio. Whenever there is secondary sexual characteristics are absent, so go for the LH-FSH and see if the FSH is high. Okay, so if there is high FSH and there are absent secondary sexual characters, and if this patient has got hypertension along with that, then the answer for such questions, if they come in the exam, is 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. 3 things: high FSH, absent secondary sexual characters, and hypertension. Check the blood levels of 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone in these patients, because alpha hydroxyprogesterone will be less, right? Whenever there is high FSH, LH is also high, with short stature, these patients are generally Turner syndrome. Okay, so we need to do karyotyping in them. You may find that it is XO. Patients with high FSH and LH and normal height may indicate ovarian failure or male karyotype. In such cases, a karyotype should be obtained. There is a high risk for the development of gonadoblastoma and dysgerminoma with XY karyotype. Okay. So basically, in AIS patient, there can be high FSHLH. There can be high FSHLH with everything normal in cases of patients with mosaic Turner, or in also in cases of patients with premature ovarian failure because of other things. High FSH and normal karyotype can be associated with autoimmune premature ovarian failure. So premature ovarian failure can occur because of many, many factors. So it can be because of the autoimmune factors, can be because of the problems with the karyotype, right? It can be because of radiotherapy, chemotherapy, so idiopathic, all these causes premature ovarian failure. So in whenever there is no problem with the HPO axis, and then you'll have that, you'll find that the gonad failure will only cause high FSH, there'll be no problem otherwise with the patient. So in cases where you find that FSH and LH both are low, the stature is short, so this occurs in intracranial lesions like cranopharyngiomas. Whenever there is LH, FSH, there is low LH and FSH, which is either low or around normal, but normal height may indicate weight loss, celiac disease, type 1 diabetes, anorexia nervosa, or exercise. Severe exercise can cause low LH, and FSH may be low or normal, but normal height. Okay, so this whole table gives a lot of differentials. Let's look at secondary amenorrhea. Whenever there were high FSH levels, that is more than 20 on two occasions, it is suggestive of premature ovarian failure or insufficiency in a patient with who is less than 40 years. So basically, remember, premature ovarian failure is whenever there is ovarian failure for in patients who are less than 40 years. So it can be whenever you do LH FSH in this patient, see if that if it is a lower normal FSH. We have seen that it can be because of weight loss, stress, excessive exercise, and there is increased LH FSH ratio, then it is PCOS, right? Now this is basically what you'll see in different patients there. So if there is gonadal dysgenesis, then the karyotype will be a problem. It can be AIS or Turner's. If there is ovarian failure, then you'll see that karyotype will be XX, but the estrogen will be very low, right? So whenever the estrogen is low, do karyotype. If it is XX, then it is basically ovarian failure. When you find that the T4 levels and the TRH levels are high, then it is mainly hypothyroidism. Whenever the TRH is normal and T4 is normal and you do a pituitary imaging, you find a tumor, it can be a prolactinoma or a pituitary tumor. And whenever you find that FSH is low, then it can be, it is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Normal FSH and increased LH is more suggestive of PCOS. Now, amenorrhea of hypothalamic or CNS origin. Remember, there are many causes. In primary, we know that weight loss, severe exercise, genetic problems like Kallmann syndrome, all our idiopathic, all these things will cause primary amenorrhea. Same in secondary. So when there is severe weight loss, exercise, chronic illness, and sometimes even psychological stress, all these things will cause secondary amenorrhea. We know that a BMI of more than 19 is essential prior to the menarche for puberty to progress normally. There has been some evidence that a critical fat mass of 22% is required for this sequence of events to occur. Okay, so BMI should be more than 19. Amenorrhea for a prolonged period before the bone mass is achieved leads to osteoporosis. These females are referred to as female, as to having a female athlete triad. basically, these females will have problems with the eating. So it can be either anorexia or bulimia. They'll have amenorrhea because of a very low BMI, and because if it is there for too long, it will cause osteoporosis. Treatment. These patients need to be given gonadotropins to induce ovulation, and menstruation can be continued by giving combined Ocipels, right? But of course, these patients basically have problems with eating, amenorrhea, osteoporosis. So these patients basically have problems at the level of psychology, and that is why they need to be seen by a dietitian and psychiatrist on a long-term basis, right? So as to bring them back to a BMI of more than 19. Constitutional delay is characterized by positive family history, right? The patients may have short stature, they may have delayed secondary sexual characteristics, and this may happen in a family, right? So basically, it all depends on how the parents are. So there can be a constitutional delay in these patients. About idiopathic hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, it is a defect that develops in the development or function of the gonads, resulting from inadequate secretion of the pituitary gonadotropins. The cause is unknown, and the hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism may only be distinguished from constitutional delay once the estrogen therapy is withdrawn, okay, on completion of the pubertal development. Now, when we are giving this estrogen therapy to these patients of hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, and when we withdraw this therapy, then in patients who have got this constitutional delay, they will still have a normal hormonal levels, and their whole growth will again be very normal. They'll have normal menses after that. But in patients who have got hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, once the estrogen is removed, it'll all stop. She'll again have amenorrhea, and she'll again have problems later on, right? A very important cause of secondary amenorrhea, that is PCOS. It is still a debate as to the pathophysiology, but we know that there are many different reasons why it may occur. Because of the in utero programming of the hypothalamus, there can be insulin metabolism that works in it, or it can be because of the lifestyle factors, which is very popular, right? PCOS is often familial, and a number of potential genes have been implicated. Now, we have been seeing that chronic illness patients, they again have general debilitation, and that is why they have problems with the hypothalamic function, and which causes amenorrhea. The space-occupying lesions, we have seen that craniopharyngiomas, germinomas, gliomas, all of these are rare but may cause, if they tend to occur around the time of puberty, then they'll cause amenorrhea by disrupting the tonic inhibition of dopamine on prolactin release, and it will compress and destroy the hypothalamic and pituitary tissue. Now, these will present as headache, visual problems, because of the big tumors there, right? Also, if it is a prolactinoma, it will cause galactorrhea. So if there is a pituitary hormone dysfunction, which will show up as galactorrhea, then you have to think of all these space occupying lesions. The diagnosis will involve cranial imaging. It will require a neurosurgical input, of course, and these patients will require a surgery. They'll require a destructive therapy in the form of surgery or radiotherapy, and later on, of course, because of the problems with the amenorrhea that may arise later again, because we are dealing with the pituitary and the hypothalamus, these patients will require HRTs to maintain the health afterwards, right? Now, colmans again is a very important cause of amenorrhea. It is rare, but the congenital absence of GnRH neurons, whose cell bodies should migrate from the olfactory area to the arcuate nucleus of the hypothalamus, with the axons extending down the tuberoinfundibular tract to connect with the portal vasculature of the anterior pituitary gland. It is associated with anosmia and color blindness. Basically, we know that there is problems with the GnRH neurons there. They are all absent, and that is why these patients will not have problems with smelling. So there will be anosmia, there will be color blindness, and all this together will result in amenorrhea. So this is about hyperprolactinoma. You should know the basic values. The value less than 500 is normal. Less than 1000, it basically means it is either because of the stress or whenever there is recent breast examination, this causes stimulation and results in increase in the prolactin levels, right? So in such cases, you just need to repeat the prolactin levels. Whenever it is 700 to 2500, that basically means that it is a cause which is treatable, like hypothyroidism or PCOS. So you just need to check TSH, T4, LH, FSH, testosterone, SHBG later on, right? But if it is very high but still less than 3000, that means it can be a macroadenoma, which is non-functioning, to see if there are any pituitary tumors there. But if it is very, very high and around 4000, then it can be a functioning microadenoma, right? Of course, these patients need to be referred to the endocrinologist and the surgeons. The treatment, though you don't need to remember everything, just to know what are the basics on how to treat hyperprolactinemia cases, because they are very common to be seen in our field, right? So of course, we can give the medical treatment to these patients. We can give her bromocriptine, starting with a very low dose of 1.25 nocturnally for 5 nights, and then gradually titrating to 7.5 daily in 2 or 3 divided doses for about 3 weeks, okay? So bromocriptine can be given, but we need to know the adverse side effects, that is nausea, vomiting, headache, postural hypertension, okay? So that is why we are starting it with from the nights and then taking the tablets with food. So it will reduce the risk of postural hypertension. Okay. The long-term adverse effects may be constipation, psychiatric problems. All these things can appear with bromocriptine. Cabergoline, again, a very commonly used drug, 0.25 to 1 milligrams can be given twice weekly up to 1 milligram daily. These are longer acting. They are better tolerated by many patients, but 10% may have unacceptable adverse effects, right? Of course, both of them will have psychiatric adverse effects, and that is why they are not licensed for use in pregnancy. It's about cabergoline and quinagolide, okay? So cabergoline and quinagolide should remain second line. Again, quinagolide, we have seen that 25 to 150 micrograms can be given in divided doses daily. Of course, when it is very intolerable, you may go for surgery, transsphenoidal transection of adenoma. Whenever there are intolerable adverse effects of medication, there are non-functioning adenomas, or there is a supracellular extension which cannot be resolved with medicine. Of course, the last thing is pituitary irradiation. It may not be that much required, but whenever it is required, it will again cause a lot of complications later on, right? Like panhypopituitarism and all. So basically, you need to know about bromocriptine and cabergoline and quinagolide, right? Now, what are the rare causes of pituitary amenorrhea? It can be empty cella syndrome, Sheehan syndrome, trauma, head injury, infections like tuberculosis. It can be congenital, it can be idiopathic. So all these things will cause pituitary amenorrhea. Okay. Now, again, a very important thing of ovarian origin, amenorrhea of ovarian origin. So it can be premature ovarian failure, it can be dysgenesis, it can be Y chromosomal material, it can be autoimmune or iatrogenic type of premature ovarian failure, or it can be only just PCOS, which is causing amenorrhea. The premature ovarian failure is defined as cessation of ovarian function below the age of 40 years. It affects approximately 1% of women, and the incidence may include up to 30% of amenorrheic women. Right? So unlike the testes, the ovaries are devoid of gametes and are unable to produce normal amounts of steroid hormones, leading to elevated concentrations of serum gonadotropins. Basically, the gonads are not functioning, and that is why the serum gonadotropins are increasing. Now we know that the maximum number of germ cells there are around 7 million, and it is reached at 20 weeks of gestation and will have already fallen to 1 to 2 million by birth. Okay, so at birth, we have around 1 to 2 million germ cells. Then, when the puberty starts, approximately around 250,000 follicles will remain in the potential for up to 500 ovulations. So basically, by the time the menopause occurs, only 1,000 follicles will be left. So this is all the mechanism on how things will occur in the ovary, a normal one. Now, how to diagnose a premature ovarian insufficiency patient. So whenever the FSH is more than 20 on two or more occasions, of course, we have to diagnose this patient as premature ovarian insufficiency when she is less than 40 years of age, right? Of course, the other things needs to be done to go for the differential, that is karyotyping, ovarian antibody screen, autoimmune diseases screening, infections, and also need to do the bone densitometry scan to find how much is the effect of the amenorrhea on the bones, right? It can be seen that the cause is not known in around 2/3 of the cases of premature ovarian failure. We know about the gonadal dysgenesis, again, a very important cause of ovarian origin. Turners, which is the most common of that, and turners will be, the patients will be very short. There'll be problem with the any primordial oocytes reaching the gonads undergo accelerated and premature attrition. Okay, so up to 25% will enter the puberty spontaneously, but only 10% will progress to the puberty, and only 1% will develop ovulatory cycles. We know that there are many other causes, like idiopathic causes, autoimmune causes of premature ovarian insufficiency. This is how the Turner's girl will look like, right? So she'll have a short stature, she'll be having problems with the ovaries may be streak, there'll be low estrogen, there'll be high LH, FSH. The facial features will be like micrognathia, epicentral folds, prominent ears, fish-like mouth, faces. Chest will be having widely spaced nipples, neck will be short, webbed, low hairline, cardiovascular problems like coarctation of aorta, hypertension, aortic wall problems. And that is why when these patients, our mosaic types, or specifically when these patients ovulate and become pregnant sometimes, then we need to keep an eye on the cardiovascular features there, because if she has got coarctation, then there is a high chance of aortic dissection. These patients will have problems like horseshoe kidney rotation, or even hydronephrosis or duplication of the kidney. Skin may have hypoplastic nails, lymphedema, skeletal problems like cubitus valgus, short fourth, metacarpal, tarsal, and high arched palate, right? So whenever there is abnormality with the uterus or the outflow tract, all the hormones will be normal, but the problem will be only with the flow outside, okay? So the congenital abnormality can arise. So basically, it can be because of just a transverse septum, or it can be a Roque-Tansky syndrome, a Marquette syndrome, or AIS, right? Or sometimes can only be iatrogenic causes like Asherman's or pelvic radiotherapy, cervical stenosis. MRKH will cause primary amenorrhea. There will be gonadal dysgenesis in 40%. And we know that there is Mullerian agenesis in this patient. So the vagina will be absent or hypoplastic. The uterus will usually be absent, right? Although there may be a small non-functioning rudimentary remnant type of uterus, okay? And these patients will generally be having a renal problem like horseshoe kidney, hydronephrosis. So all these things will come up in the exam as questions. And they'll say that this patient has got primary amenorrhea and she has got no uterus inside and or a uterus which is rudimentary and a renal problem, then of course the answer is MRKH, right? But remember that the ovarian development and function is normal in MRKH, right? Whenever there is imperforate hymen because of transverse vaginal septum or it can be because of the cervical stenosis and other things, you need to do a treatment for that. A surgery will be useful for that. In all these cases, establish the patency. We need to remove the rudimentary structure, right? And in the interim between the diagnosis and surgery, whenever in between periods, so whenever you have got imperforate hymen, say for example, and you are going to do a surgery, there is going to be a time that the periods will not occur and this may hamper the whole health of the patient. So menses may be suppressed with GnRH analog therapy in these interim. Okay. Cruciate incision on imperforate hymen is of course going to help her, and this will not require any subsequent dilatation because it's just the film there which is stopping the menses. Patients, of course, these can be because of different problems. It may just not be a transverse septa, it may be associated with other congenital problems, and that is why it needs to be seen by tertiary centers in access of multidisciplinary specialist input from the plastic surgeon. Vaginal dilators will be required in cases of patients with who have got problems like cervical stenosis, like vaginal stenosis, or sometimes also it can be required for patients who have got a Rokitansky, that is MRK syndrome, though it is not very much required in these patients because they have got good vaginal length. But of course, in patients who have got AIS or in patients who have got have problems of vaginal stenosis, so you may, or radiotherapy there, which can cause vaginal stenosis, then you require vaginal dilators, right? Psychological support is very important throughout this treatment. We know about AIS, we have spoken about it, that the cardiotype of 46XY, but these patients will have a female phenotype, and these patients, of course, are going to require a lot of psychological help. These patients will not have any secondary sexual characters like that of a male. Basically, there will be no hair because there is androgen insensitivity, right? But these patients, because the ovaries are basically testes, they are at a very high risk of malignancy. So you need to remove the testes once the growth spurt occurs. So because up till that time, these testes or even these gonads which are there can be useful for pubertal transition and normal early breast development, right, of the patient. So that is why there'll be completion of growth spurt, and after that you go for AIS. In cases of hormone replacement, in cases of patients with AIS, hormone replacement is of course very important to maintain the patient's bone as well as also to maintain the health of the patient, because then if she is devoid of all these hormones, everything is going to have problems. Her bones, she may have osteoporosis and all the possible things, right? So basically, to avoid that, hormone replacement is given to this patient to maintain her as a female, right? Vaginal dilatation may be required for these patients, and counseling and support is a very important thing. In patients who have got any kind of dilatation curettage, that is very overzealous, or there is overzealous postpartum curettage, it may cause secondary amenorrhea because of Asherman syndrome. Right? So you may require HSG or hysteroscopy to see multiple synecae, and that time also you can just release these synecae. Okay? Also, in cases of uterine artery embolization patients, there can be a problem with of Asherman syndrome happening later on. Okay? Also, in cases of pelvic radiotherapy, treatment of course is lysis of this all these adhesions, keep a pediatric catheter inside and keep it for 7 days to prevent adhesions forming again, right? Give her anti-inflammatory, give her antibiotics for 1 day, and HRT should be given to help restore the menstrual flow in these patients, right? Up to 80% of these can conceive later following the treatment, but the pregnancy is frequently complicated by premature labor, abnormal placentation, and postpartum hemorrhage because of the damage to the endometrium inside, right? So basically, this is how amenorrhea should be approached. And once you know how to deal with whenever there is high FSH, low FSH, prolactin levels, if you remember all these things, if you remember the investigations to be done and the causes of primary and secondary amenorrhea, you can easily write down all the right answers to this question. I hope this video was useful for you. Thank you very much, guys.